Somebody asked me if I bought my tickets. I don't buy anything. People give me everything. Oh, see. Oh, see. Look through the offering plates and all kinds of winning numbers. Diamond rings, chickens.
You're going to split it if you win.
That's right. I'll split it if I win it. Oh, my goodness. What do you think Jeremiah meant when he said, for reals, what do you think Jeremiah meant when he said the heart is, what did he say? Desperately wicked. Who can know it? What do you think he meant? that our heart is desperately wicked. Nothing good in us. We're sinners. One of my preachers used to say, God not only loved us so much that he was willing to die for all the sins we've committed, Jesus loved us so much he was willing to die for us, knowing what sins we would commit if we thought we could get away with it. Yeah. What sins would you commit if you thought... Somebody got me first. Can you imagine? Can you imagine? If you could get away with anything... Okay, not you. Are there any people in your life, don't throw out names, are there people in your life that you would be desperately afraid of if you knew that they could get away with anything?
Yes.
It's scary, isn't it? It's scary. I mean, we were talking about, not too long ago, elementary school kids. You can already see which way they're bent. You can already see the way they're thinking. What are they going to be like when they're in middle school? What is it going to take to change a little heart that if it's already is a little, what, second, third grader, already, if I could, what are they going to be like when they can? Yeah. The heart is desperately wicked. Who can know it? You guys are familiar with this guy. Watch this next video. This is here in Albuquerque, huh?
The outcome of this hearing will determine if Griego will be committed to CYFD custody for a few years or if he will serve multiple life sentences.
15?
Now, Griego pleaded guilty 18? To 2 counts of second-degree murder and 3 counts of child abuse resulting in death. Lawyers on both sides will present evidence and argue as to whether Griego can receive treatment. If the judge agrees to treatment, Griego will be released from CYFD custody when he is 21 years old.
So he's 18
However,
now, 19, 20,
if the judge
21.
Decides Griego cannot be treated, he will be tried as an adult, and he faces up to 3 life sentences plus 30 years in jail.
That's pretty, what is that? Is that sad? Is it tragic? Is it disgusting, despicable?
All of the above. It's tragic in all senses of the word.
Tragic in all senses of the word? Now, there's a possibility he's going to get out when he's what? When he's 21 years old, right? There's a possibility. He's 18 now? So if he's tried as a kiddo, yeah, or I guess now that he's not even going to be tried, isn't that right? A judge is going to decide, I think is what I heard last night or this morning, that a judge is going to decide what his outcome will be. So it's not going to be a jury thing, if I understood correctly. So this happened how many years ago? Just a couple of years ago? 3 years ago? And you remember, I mean, right around the corner from here is where it happened, huh? Little thug. Kid who grew up on the streets, awful kid, broken home, church kid, a loving family, pastor's kid. Yeah, now they're saying all kinds of things, huh? The defense is saying he was this, he was afraid, he was abused, he was this, he was that. So if they let him off as a child, he killed, now he admitted to how many? The mom, the dad. And so I think, what was it, first or second degree murder, and then child abuse that resulted in death. So he killed 5 family members. And he could be out in 3 years. I mean, there are guys who are serving time for rolling their own that are doing more than 6 years. Yeah? It's just, it's weird. Everything is just kind of upside down. They said that if they try him as an adult, or if he's treated as an adult, there's a possibility that he could get 3 life sentences. I'm not sure why 3. I think 3 life sentences plus life?
30.
Plus 30. 3 life sentences plus 30. and a life sentence anymore. I don't even know what that means. 25 years is a life. That's amazing, huh? And depending on whether they run, is it consecutive or concurrent? I don't know which is which, but side by side. Concurrent is side by side, so you're okay. Yeah, yeah. So I'm doing this way, where the other way is this way in my. Or now this wasn't even brought up. Where would execution even come? That doesn't even factor in. Now what did God say? Do you remember when Noah got off the ark? If a man takes another man's life, if he takes innocent life. Yeah, now God seems to make allowances for, he takes into account, it appears, war, self-defense, accidental death. And when Noah got off the ark, he made it very clear to Noah, life is sacred. Man's blood is holy, that is, you know, unto the Lord. And if a person takes an innocent life, he forfeits his life. In the Old Testament law, God said to Moses, if a guy takes a life, he loses his life, he forfeits his life. In Jesus' day, there was at least one person who was brought to him guilty of a crime worthy of execution, and it was the sin of what? Do you remember? What horrid sin was it? Adultery. Yeah, times have changed a little bit, huh? So this woman was caught in the act of adultery, and they brought her, she was caught in the act of adultery by herself? I don't think so, but they didn't bring the dude. They only brought the girl because it was a trap. They couldn't care less about that. It was a crime worthy of death, according to Old Testament law. And what did Jesus say? Well, yeah, stone her. That's what the law says. But let you who is without sin cast the first stone. Now, he wasn't saying don't judge. The Bible is very clear. Judge righteously. There's a time for capital punishment, evidently. But evidently, there are times that God allows for extending mercy. God allows for extending grace. But the rule, the beginning, was when Noah got out of the box, when Noah got out of the ark, when he said, you take a life, you take innocent life, you forfeit your life. Capital punishment was instituted by God. Some would say, look, if you just look at this unemotionally, 5 premeditated murder. There's no accident about this. He was texting beforehand. I still don't understand why they didn't arrest the little girlfriend. They were plotting this stuff. They were planning both parents. But she's testifying against him, for him. I don't understand. But if you were looking at this dispassionately, you're just hearing about the story, a kid thinking ahead, talking to someone about it, planning, lying in wait, kills 5 people. Is there a crime worthy of capital punishment? Some would say, my goodness. Not a kid on the street, church kid. So what's the moral of the story? Don't raise your kids in church. Don't be a PK. Don't be a pastor's kid. What about, isn't it a solid, set in granite promise? Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he's old, he'll not depart from it. Isn't that a promise from the Lord? No, those proverbs are not promises. They're principles. It's not a promise. I mean, some of us know kids. Some of us raise kids. Some of us know kids, not necessarily mine, but some of us have raised kids that we loved them, and we prayed for them, and we sacrificed for them, and you think, oh, man, if this doesn't change, whoa, if this doesn't change. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he's old, he'll not depart from it, is not a promise. It's in the Proverbs. It's a principle. The principle is, look at how your kid's already bent. Do what you can to make sure he's bent in God's direction, but train him up in a way that he responds. We have 2 kids now, right? I forget their names. They make me so angry. Elmer and Shauna. Who's the other one? Oh, yeah, Scar. Scar was the wild. They're very good right now. Scar was the wild child. Scar was just wild. He was just wild. And will he ever learn? Will he ever quit chewing on things? Will he ever? And as soon as we brought in Elmer, Scar just became the... Scar's so cool, and Scar's very thoughtful and considerate. And I mean, he can get after it with his brother, you know, but he's just... And Elmer... Elmer's Elmer. He's a little Saffy Daffy. He's so cute. Yeah? If we try to train them the same way, well, good luck with that. It's not happening. They're just kind of different. They respond to different things. They're scared about certain things. Kids are not puppies. Puppies are easier. But train up a child in the way he should go. You pick up on personality traits. You pick up on God's principles. Train up a child in the way he should go is not a promise. It's a principle. Do you think Nehemiah was raised up in the Lord? Well, yeah, he was. What happened? Who knows what happened? But would you agree that when we grow up in church, we should be different? Yeah. I mean, it shouldn't... the New Testament says that there are certain sins that shouldn't be named among us. My goodness, I would guess murder would be one of those things that you would expect church people wouldn't be guilty of. God goes out of his way. The Lord, the Holy Spirit, through the Apostle Paul, goes out of his way to say, sexual sin should not be named among you. Shouldn't even happen in churches. We're kind of normal that way, aren't we? I mean, kind of normal like the world. Is there an unwritten... I've got a written list, but nobody reads my list. It's not in the Bible. I wrote it in the Bible because it's just in my pen. Is there a written list somewhere that these are the sins that unbelievers commit and these are the sins that are okay for believers to commit? Is there like a list somewhere that I've missed? I mean, if it's not okay for an unbeliever, it shouldn't be okay for a believer, right? But don't we... Not you, because you're... But most Christians, don't they kind of seem like they have a... I don't know, kind of a standard that kind of stretches, kind of, you know, it kind of, well, what I usually talk about a sinometer. You know, there are way bad sins, ooh, bad sins, then there's little bitty sins. You know, like big lies and the little fibs, you know, like some sins are really big and some sins, they're not even sins, they're just my bads. You know, oh, my bad, you know, my bad. And then big old sins. You know, sometimes, oop, sorry, did I say that? And then palabras así, now big old bad words. And then somebody, you know. Should it be that way with believers? It's not supposed to be, right? Jesus said, let your yes be yes, your no be no. James said that sweet waters and bitter waters shouldn't come from the same stream. Yeah, it ought to be a little bit different. Christians should be different, but I guess the question is how different? Tell me what you think about this. We were joking about it.
Over the commercial break, I was thinking about my lotto ticket. And again, for those of you just joining us, I am going to win. And anybody want to see the winning numbers? Right there. Kapow! There it is. Now, alarmingly, there seems to be one thing standing in my way. Other people buying tickets. I did not see that coming.
Now, where in the Bible does it say thou shalt not buy $2 worth of hope? It doesn't say that anywhere. I mean, that's one of the ones in mine. Yeah, but it doesn't say anywhere in the Bible. Is that what it was, $2 worth of hope? Yeah, that some people do that because they see the possibility of maybe seeing some financial daylight and maybe doing some of the things that they've always dreamed of doing. Were we talking about the guy who almost gave away $2 million a while ago? A guy, was it here in New Mexico or Albuquerque? I don't know. He went in and he bought in Deming. And he bought lots of money just floating around in Deming, right? Not a lot of money floating around in Deming, but enough to buy a lottery ticket, enough to buy a Powerball ticket, enough to buy, and I don't know, what you buy a ticket, what is it, a buck, and for another buck you double it or something? And he said, no, he didn't want to buy two tickets. He just wanted to double the one he got. And he turned to the guy behind him, like we do at Piggly Wiggly. What's this over here? At Albertsons, where they're doing the Monopoly game. And are you saving these? And I got tired of saying no. So I just take them and ask the guy behind me if he's, you know, saving them. I guess he offered to sell it to the guy behind him. He said no. So he ended up winning $2 million. Now, I'm not against anybody coming across money. I'm not against you receiving a financial windfall. Yay, God. Yay, you. But you know my position on gambling, it's a little no. Yeah? It's a lot no. It's not a little bit, it's a big old no. It's a big no. So before we dig into what it is, what's my beef with it? What do I think is wrong with it? Why do I have anything against anybody throwing down a couple of bucks and winning a couple of million? What do I care if you put down $2 and get $2 billion? What is it now, 1.5? 1.5
billion?
1.4 billion dollars. That's crazy. That's insanely crazy. Now, you're not going to get all that, but still got a pretty big chunk. Yeah. So what problem do I have with it? Have you anybody been with me long enough that you can hazard a guess? What do I care? Chickens. You all got tickets, don't you? You all have tickets. Everybody's sitting there all quiet. You better tithe, you sinners. Oh, man. Yeah, everybody's tithe will be about $4 off, $2 off. Do I think it's a sin?
No,
I don't think it's a sin to go to the casino. Do I think it's a sin? Now, if you listen to me long enough, you think I think it is, but I don't think it's a sin. So what concern could I possibly have? I mean, we're just talking here. It's just us.
It's like greed, I guess.
Greed? Why would I see greed in it? Maybe I'm just a...
You want to make more? That's why you go, because you figure you're going to win more.
Now, some people think that's why we start businesses. Because we start businesses because we want to make money. Is that true? Yeah. Heck yeah! Yeah, yeah. At the casino, if anybody, or lottery, anything, where does that money come from? You know, the losers. You can't win if somebody doesn't lose. Now, in business, if business is right, the way free market capitalism works, ideally, it's a win-win. I've got $2 in my pocket, and I like having $2 in my pocket, but I'm a little hungry, and chewing on paper is not very satisfying. You can put a little peanut butter on it, but it is not the same. And Eric's got a loaf of bread over there that he'll sell me for $2, but Jim will sell me a loaf for $1. It's day-old stuff, and I think, Now, that $2 loaf, it's still kind of squishy. I like that. But I can buy a day-old from his store, and I can get a loaf of bread for $1 and still have $1 in my pocket. Now, I really like having the money, but I really like having the bread too. So he likes having the bread, but right now he's got bread and he'd just as soon have my money. So I trade him my paper that doesn't taste very good for his bread that tastes pretty good. And I might go for the two or I might go for the one. Yeah. And that's free market capitalism. It's a win-win. He'd rather have my dollar. I'd rather have his bread. Yeah. My understanding is the only people who come out, Donald Trump, great godly man, not so much. Standing against gambling? No, he owns casinos. Standing against drinking? No, he owns booze places, casinos. He owns a casino. Enough said right there. But he knows enough not to gamble, and he knows enough not to drink. You know why? Because the house never loses. Yeah. You can't win in that situation unless a bunch of people are losing. Seems to me, again, and my concern is that. My concern is that when people gamble, even if it's just $1, my concern is that it messes up our heart. Maybe I'm extreme. I am. But, I mean, you know my position. You can't fall in the ditch across the street if you're walking over there. If the ditch is on that side of the street, on that side of the road, and you're walking, usually if it's a ditch, it's not a street, it's a road, right? If there's a ditch on that side of the road and I'm on that side of the road, I can't accidentally fall in. But if I'm walking over there close to the ditch and I'm sorry, Mom, I fell and it was an accident. What are you doing on that side of the road? Saffy Daffy, that would be Elmer. That's not an accident. And so I think stay away on this. The Bible doesn't say don't. This is my position on drinking, right? The Bible doesn't say don't drink. Now, Jesus turned water into grape juice. The Bible doesn't say thou shalt not drink. It doesn't say that drinking is a sin. So what's my beef with a... on a summer afternoon. You can't get drunk if you don't have a drink. I know it's an extreme position. Okay, so I asked all that. I said all that to say this, huh? Two questions. Are Christians supposed to be different from unbelievers? Yes. Second question, how different then? Is it okay to commit murder?
No.
No. Is it okay to, careful, hypothetically now, is it okay to gamble?
Yes.
Yeah. Wow, that was way too fast. And she waves the ticket. Yes. I'll bet you it is okay. I'll bet you it is. We all kind of have a sinometer, don't we? We all kind of have an idea of what sins I would never do, what activities I would never engage in. And then there are other activities that the crazy people like Tony would say, you should never engage in those activities. But most people think that's extreme. I'm even running out of a bottom side of the thermometer here. Yeah, if we have sinometers where we think, well, you know, some things, I know I'm not supposed to fib, but many believers don't see fibbing as lying. Yeah. If we take a pen from the bank, does the bank still have pens? I don't know. You know, that's not the same as stealing $10,000 from the bank. You know, I just took a pen. We don't see it the same. Does God have a sinometer? Sin is sin. No little sins, no big sins. So at what point? Which one are we talking about? Some sins are unto death. There is a sin unto death. Is it a specific sin? Huh? Unbelief. Now, unbelief. Yeah, yeah. I think the sin of the blasphemy against the Holy Spirit, which seems to be the sin of unbelief, looks like it's different from the sin unto death. I'm not saying that some of you haven't sinned the sin unto death. We're just kind of throwing stuff out here. I don't see the sin unto death as a specific sin. You know, it's adultery, or it's stealing over $10,000, or it's lying seven times, or, you know, I don't think it's a specific sin. It seems to me that it's finally when God sees the attitude in the heart of a believer as so worldly, so close to an unbeliever, he said, you know what? You've already messed up your life enough. Come on home, mijo. You know, come on. Enough. It seems like it's different. If gambling is an expression of greed, it's wrong. It's just wrong. It's just sin. If I start a business out of greed, is that okay? The problem is still greed, isn't it? It's an attitude of the heart. I mean, if I take an offering and greed is involved, that's a problem. If I ask you for money and I really think that it's going to bless you and bless God, and there's no greed involved, listening to Jesse Duplantis, you know, Jesse's a good storyteller. Shoot, I laugh. And Kenneth Copeland, he's just crazy. Listening to Kenneth and Jesse talk about why they need their personal jets, why they need their ministry jets. Why are you guys shaking your head? They need them. They don't? Why not? They don't need two or three? Sometimes you get bored. Sometimes you need a different plane. Most people see that as a problem, don't they? Why? Because they think that preacher is full of greed. Yeah. Now, I don't know. I think we would all... Oh, yeah, greed is the word we were looking for. That preacher is full of, yeah, you would think something else, yeah. Greed was the word we were looking for right there. All right. So I think we're in agreement. Believers should be different from unbelievers.
How different should believers be
from unbelievers? We're going to stand before the Lord. You know, your decisions, my decisions, we're going to stand before the Lord. You're not going to stand before me in judgment. You're going to stand before the Lord. And I'm just doing the best I can. I'm not doing the best I can. I'm moving in that direction, though. At some point, before I stand before the Lord, I hope I'm doing the best I can to help you stand before the Lord confidently and unashamed. And I'm just convinced that the more you see activities of the world as stuff you really don't want to do, the better off you're going to be when you stand before the Lord. What do I care if you buy $2 worth of hope? What do I care if you buy a scratcher? What do I care if you buy a Powerball ticket? What do I care if you go to the casino? What do I care if you have a drink? What do I care if you have a potty mouth? Really, what do I care? I care about you. And when you stand before Jesus, I don't want you to have to go. You know, if I just had a couple more days, I could have cleaned up my act. You know, I could have got ready, you know, could have dusted myself off a little better. He wants us to be able to stand before him confident and unashamed. We started a couple of weeks ago talking about what's new, really. You know, it's a new year. We're talking about doing new things and setting New Year's resolutions and, you know, turning over a new leaf. Well, what's new, really? 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. Paul said it like this. Therefore, everything that came before, I said all that to say this. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, if he's a believer, if you're saved, if you're born again, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old is done away, it's gone, and the new is right now. The new is here. And I ask the question, well, what's new, really? I mean, Solomon said there's nothing new under the sun, but then Paul says all the old is gone and everything is new, and I think we kind of settled on, well, everything about you after you get saved ought to be new. When you gave your life to Jesus Christ, you ought to be different. When I came to the Lord, I should be different. We may not be in agreement on how different, but I think we'd all agree that if you've come to the Lord, you should be different. So we're looking to Scripture. We're appealing to Scripture and asking, so what really is different? We said last week you could look forward to a new place. As a believer, you get a new place for worship, Revelation chapter 3, verse 12. The one who is victorious, to the one who's victorious, I will make a pillar in the temple of my God. Never again will they leave it. I will write on them the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the new Jerusalem, which is coming down out of heaven from my God. And suffice it to say that when you actually leave this life and go to be with the Lord, there's going to be some transition in there, but at some point, the New Jerusalem comes down from heaven, and you and God will live together in the New Jerusalem. You're going to get a brand new place, okay? Doesn't look like we're going to spend eternity in heaven. Looks like we're going to spend eternity with all the heavenlies in the New Jerusalem. I don't get it. It just appears that that's the case. We all get a new place for worship, and we all get a new place to work, Isaiah 65, verse 17. The Lord said through Isaiah, see, I will create a new heaven and a new earth. The former things will not be remembered. They will not even come to mind. My chosen ones will long enjoy the work of their hands. They will not labor in vain. They will be a people blessed by the Lord. So again, we talked about it last week. I don't know what kind of work we're going to be doing, but I know it's going to be fulfilling. I know it's going to be, dare I say, fun. I don't know what fun is. I know whatever we enjoy here, it's going to be way gooder there. Yeah? Well, how could it be fun if there's no sea? When I love fishing and I love boating and I love walking on the beach and drinking piña. How does that go? And whatever I wrote on my, yeah, my Christian mingle. What is that? How could I enjoy heaven if there's no ocean? I've had people ask me the same kind of question, but they fill in the blank. How can it be heaven if there isn't going to be any whatever? I promise. Whatever is fun here is going to be way better there. Whatever is good here is going to be way gooder there. It's going to be heaven. God is the one who wired us. He's the one who made us. He's the one who created whatever we think is fun. He's the one who created whatever we think is fulfilling. He's the one who created whatever we feel is awesome and good and great and yay and, oh, I don't want this to ever end. He's the one who wired us. He knows us. And whatever is good here in this sinful creation, it's going to be so much more gooderist over there. You like that for a superlative? So amazing, I had to make up a new word. So what's going to be new, really? Well, he's going to give us a new place for worship, and a new place to work. Well, that's what he's going to do. What's he going to do? I mean, what's new, really? And again, it ought to be everything about you. It ought to be everything about me after we're saved. He's going to give us a new place, a new position. Now, you're in Christ right now, right? The Bible says that you're in Christ. The Bible says at some point you will be in Christ, and it says you are in Christ. The Bible says at some point you will be in the heavenlies. The Bible says in other places you are presently seated with Christ in the heavenlies. You're in Christ because of your faith. You are right now in God's family. Because of your salvation, right now you're in God's service. We may be doing a good job or a not so good job, but right now we're in His service. We work for the Lord. And because of our hope, we're in God's heart. Already. We're already there. The Bible says we're already accepted in the beloved. Already. You don't have to do anything else to make Him love you more. He loves you more than we could ever imagine. He loves us as much now as He ever will. He's given believers a new birth. When you gave your life to Him, you were what, born again. Peter says it like this, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In His great mercy, He has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Titus says it like this, Titus chapter 3, verse 5. At one time, we too were foolish. We're not foolish anymore, right? Or disobedient. Or deceived. Or enslaved by all kinds of passions from this world or pleasures. That was who we used to be. We're supposed to be different. We lived in malice, in envy, being hated, hating one another. But after we got saved, after everything became new, some of us ought to be squirming already. When the kindness and love of God, our Savior, appeared, He saved us, not because of any righteous things that we had done, but because of, what does it say? Because of His mercy, because of His grace. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit. So we got saved because of what? What did we do to get saved? Nada, nothing, nothing. Did nothing to save ourselves. We didn't put aside anything to get saved. We didn't put in anything to get saved. All we did was come and recognize, oh, woe is me. Man, I'm messed up. I'm a sinner. I need You, God. I need You, Jesus. And it wasn't just the foxhole prayer. It wasn't just, oh, God, if You get me out of this. Everybody's prayed those prayers. This is a, God, if You get me out of me prayer. This is a, God, I'm dirty. I'm wicked. It's the best you'd ever been. For real. Maybe you weren't doing anything horrible. Maybe you weren't doing anything that bad. But when you could see yourself against Him, when you could see your goodness against His goodness, we don't look so good. Yeah? All of our righteousness is like a big pile of filthy rags, just like filthy rags. So He saved us not because of anything we brought to Him. He brought everything to the table. We didn't bring anything but sin and garbage and I'm sorry. And He said, come on. And He washed us up and He cleaned us and He brought us into the family. And we are born again. He says, everything about you ought to be different. I dare say that most people who say they've been saved, when I'm all by myself, I say they aren't saved. But right now I'm in mixed company, so I'm going to say, most of the people who say they've been saved, they've either forgotten or, I don't know, we'll just be gentle and leave it like that. I guess they've just forgotten where they were and how they struggled in sin and the free gift that was given by the Holy Spirit. And they went right back, like, is it Peter who said, just like a dog to his own vomit? Why would anybody want to go back to that? When you can eat tacos from the Lord, why would I want to go back to the that I threw up yesterday from the yay, I love my freedom. Why would I want to go back to that? When Jesus talked about that passage where two will be in the field, one is taken, one is left, you know, there'll be two grinding, two sleeping in bed, one taken, the other left. And we usually look at those passages and we think he's talking about the rapture. I don't know. When you look at those passages and you see what he said about wheat and tares in the field, when he says, be careful, you know, preachers, you go in there, I'm paraphrasing, you want to go in there and you want to pull the tares out and, you know, just leave great wheat in your church, you're not going to find very many people there. Wait for the Holy Spirit to do that. Where Jesus said more people are going to end up on the broadway that leads to destruction, very few people will be on the narrow path that leads to heaven. Yeah, narrow is the way, and few there be that find it. I know it sounds really insensitive. I'm afraid that most people in churches like ours aren't even saved. How judgmental, how rude, how mean. Why would I say that? When you get saved, the Holy Spirit comes inside. Everything about us ought to be different. If we're still living like that we were, we should at least be uncomfortable with that. We should at least feel bad about it. But if I can do the same bad things today that I did before I gave my life to Jesus, doesn't that kind of say maybe you didn't get it? Now, we'll be merciful and say maybe they got it and got saved, but they just don't get it. But I don't know, because it's not about you. And it's not how strong you are. It's not how you pull yourself up by your bootstraps. The Holy Spirit is the one who sanctifies. And if the Holy Spirit is not changing us, maybe he's not in us. And I'm afraid that that's what we see, whether small churches, middle churches, big churches, churches that climb on rocks, and you see the same thing. You see little sheepfolds or big sheepfolds, but I wonder how many of them are really not sheep. They sound like sheep because they go baa, but so do goats. And goats are cute. We've got little goats living next door to us, and they get out of their little place every once in a while. They come over to our place, and bah, they look so cute. But that's what God calls unbelievers. And I may think they're cute, but God wants sheep. The Lord has given believers a brand new birth. This is how you get saved. He gives you new birth. Two, he's not only given us a new birth, he's given us a new life. Acts chapter 5, verse 20. Go stand in the temple courts, he said, and tell all the people about this new life. Romans chapter 6, verse 4. We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised up from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. You're new people. We should be living a new life. We should be living out this new and living way. Is it going to sound different? I think. Is it going to look different? I think. We're going to be different. You and I might disagree on how different, but I think we'd agree, different. 1 John chapter 2, verse 29. If you know that God is righteous, you may be sure that everyone who practices righteousness has been born of him. If you've been born of God, I should practice what? Righteousness. What about you? Yeah. If you've been born of God, 1 John says, you should be practicing righteousness. 1 John chapter 3, verse 9. No one who is born of God makes a practice of sinning, because God's seed abides in that person who's born again. He cannot keep on sinning because he's been born of God. The first time I read through 1 John, 1 John was written to give us assurance of salvation. I had given my life to Jesus. Carl said, you got to start reading through the Bible. Made sense to me. So on the way to the job sites, he gave me a little pocket New Testament. So every time we'd get in the truck, he'd drive. I'd pull out my New Testament. I'd start reading. So I read through the New Testament the first week that I got saved. 1 John was written to give me assurance. I came away from reading 1 John knowing I'm not saved. No way. How could I be saved? Look. Everyone who is saved, what was that, 1 John 2:29, everyone who is born of him will practice righteousness. I wouldn't mistake me for righteous. No one who is born of God makes a practice of sinning. He cannot keep on sinning if he's been born of God. I was still sinning. I wasn't doing big bad sins, but I knew who I was on the inside. And I knew that God said I was worse than I thought I was. 1 John chapter 4, verse 7, beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God. Whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. Have you ever known a believer who didn't love anybody or anything? The guy who led me to the Lord hated everybody. You know, can you be led to the Lord by an unbeliever? I guess, but I think he was saved. These passages were written to give us assurance. Again, just like Proverbs are not promises, the Proverbs are principles to tell us how to live our life for Jesus. They're not blank check promises. If you do this, you're going to get that. They're principles. Do this because it's right. Well, what if it doesn't work out? Just do it because it's right. 1 John was written in very black and white terms. I appreciate that. If you're a Christian, you'll be like Jesus. Okay. If you're born again, you won't sin. Wow. Okay. Do I still sin? A little bit. A little bit. Well, am I a Christian? These passages ought to nudge me. And if I'm really saffy daffy, they ought to push me. They ought to smack me once in a while and remind me that if I'm born again, I ought to look like it. We may disagree on how different, but I think we'd agree if we're born again, we should be different. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God, and everyone who loves the Father loves whoever has been born of Him. Do you love everybody in church? I can't even make eye contact. some people are okay to sit next to, and some you hope you just don't make eye contact with. You know what? Because churches are made out of what?
People.
Church would be so easy if it wasn't for the... By this we know, verse 2, where am I? 1 John chapter 5, verse 2. By this we know that we are the children of God. By this we know that we love the children of God. When we love God... Let me go back. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God. And everyone who loves the Father loves whoever has been born of Him. And by this we know that we love the children of God when we love God. And when we obey His commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments. Remember Jesus asked the disciples, lovest thou me? Do you love me? And what did He say? Oh, come here, give me a kiss. Come give Jesus a little kiss. What did He say? Lovest thou me? Keep my commandments. If you love Jesus, you obey Jesus. Well, that's pretty black and white, man. And His commandments are not burdensome. Do you find it hard to keep all of His commandments? A little bit. His commandments are not burdensome. For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. Most of the people in our churches are in the world. We look like the world. We smell like the world. We talk like the world. We love the world. But this says everyone who's been born of God has been able to overcome and get away from the world. I won't buy those tickets. You can give me one. I'll preach to you. I'll take it. What do you do? What do you do, Tony? If you're so against it and someone wants to give you money won at a casino, would I take it? Yes. Heck yes. Devil's had it long enough. Time to put it in the Lord's word. Now, if I have to take it, now, for all the concerns I have with one of the ministries here in the community, one year, somebody wanted to give this particular ministry money for their it's a Christian ministry. And the director of the ministry said, I can't because the money came from, it was a bunch of young ladies who were working at one of the, shall we say, clubs, huh? A club? You don't have to say what kind. And they got, you don't know what I'm talking about. Yes, I do. And they got some money together. Bless their hearts. They got some money together, and they wanted to give it to this ministry. And he said, we can't take it. I'm trying to help guys get away from that lifestyle. I understand. I respect the position. I ought to take the money. Now, if taking the money means I have to say it's okay to do this thing or that thing, then I couldn't take it. But if they understand my position on it and they still want to give it to me, well, praise the Lord. It's God's money. It's not theirs. It's not mine. But I want to be really careful. More than likely, I'm not as careful as I like to think that I am. But there are some things that just seem so obvious. If just a few years ago, if the crime part of a city actually had a vice squad to oversee casinos, to make sure there weren't any, and now it's okay? Why? Because somebody passed a law, now it's okay? Is Gary Johnson still running? Didn't he throw his name in the hat? What was his position on drugs? Legalize them. You can control, Yeah. Legalize them, you can regulate them, you can keep people safer, you can collect revenue. He looked at everything from a almost purely business point of view. I appreciated and respected that part, but you got to have some moral compass. I mean, prostitution, okay? You could keep people safe and regulate that and make some tax revenue. Well, no, at some point you realize, no, some things are just not right. Doesn't matter how much money it brings into the government. Yeah, so again, you know, everyone who's been born of God isn't caught up in all the things that the world does. But look around. It looks like most of the people we know, we just live in this world. That's not okay. He says, be different. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. So the Lord has given believers a new birth. He's given us a new life. This new life, this is how you're changed. That you've been given a new birth, that's how you get saved. You get saved because the Holy Spirit comes and washes you. How do you get a new life? That new life happens because now that I've been changed from the inside, now I start changing on the outside. That's how people can see this brand new life. And the Lord has also given us a new name. This one's a little bit embarrassing. Usually when I pontificate and I make so clear, you know, there's a thus saith the Lord, usually I get corrected by my lovely, my lovely assistant here. But this time I was smitten by the Holy Ghost. Actually, I couldn't find any Bible to support what I believed. So, now, I mean, we've all sung songs like, there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine, and the white-robed angels sing the stories. Actually, angels aren't white-robed. The white-robed people in the Bible are saints who've been born again. But anyway, that's another thing. And another problem with a song, a new name written down in glory, I can't find it in the Bible. I'm not saying that new name isn't there. New name is there, but it's not us. Let me show you how embarrassed I am. New name. Three times you find this new name has been given. Isaiah chapter 62, verse 2. The nations will see your vindication, and all kings will see your glory. You will be called by a new name. Right there it is. You get a new name that the mouth of the Lord will bestow. But when you look at the context, you look at the passage, he's not talking about Christians. He's talking about Israel. Israel is going to be vindicated by the nations. So that's one out of, got two to go maybe. Revelation chapter 3, to him who overcomes, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God, and I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, and I will write on him my new name. But I will write on him my new name. Who's the him? Looks like this is Jesus. Looks like that's Jesus. I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, and I will write on him my new name. This is Jesus' revelation. Again, I'm saving us a little time, but when you look at the context, when you look at the, not just the verse, but look at the verse and the verses around it. Revelation chapter 2:17, to him who overcomes, I will give some of the hidden manna to eat, and I will give him a white stone, and on that stone a new name written, which no one knows except him who receives it. Except it looks like this, probably Jesus too. Now, maybe it's us, but the context makes it look like this is Jesus. Now, having said that, the Lord has given believers a new name, whole bunch of them. Let me give you just a few. You ready? Children of the promise. You've been called children of light. You've been called children of the resurrection. You've been called children of God. Next slide, I believe. There you go. Children of the promise, children of the light, children of the resurrection, children of God. Next one, a chosen people, a holy people, a people belonging to the Lord. Next one, you are fools for Christ. You are the refuse of the world. Doesn't that just make you proud? You're the scum of the earth. Nice. You've been given a new name. You are the light in the Lord. You are the sons of the light. You are the light of the world. You are the salt of the earth. You are aliens and strangers. What would Brother Trump think about that, huh?
Build a wall.
Boy, there's going to be a wall. How high is that wall going to be? I don't remember. Bigger than a monkey, that wall in the New Jerusalem. Yeah, which wall are you thinking about? Trump's? Oh, that's going to be a beautiful wall with a big door in it. We are aliens and strangers, ambassadors of Christ, doers of the word, followers of the way. The Bible says you are friends. The Bible calls you family. God calls you soldiers. God calls you slaves and servants. God calls you sons of the day. You've been given a new name. You are living stones. You are a royal priesthood. You are the aroma of Christ. You are heirs to the promise. You are the temple of the Holy Spirit. You are ministers of a new covenant. You are his flock. You are his sheep. You are God's family. You are God's household. You are God's bride. The Bible refers to you as the called, as the chosen, as the elect, as the holy, as the righteous. The Bible says you are believers, you are witnesses, you are disciples, you are saints. The Bible says you are Christians. Have you been given a new name? Bunch of them. Just not the ones that I thought. Israel will be given a new name. Jesus will be given a new name that no one will know. I don't understand all that. But your new name, this is how you're known. God's given you a new birth. This is how you're saved. You've been given a new life. This is how you're changed. And you've been given a new name. This is how you are known. You're known by the company you keep. You're known by the deeds that you do. Christ, the Creator, has made you a new creation. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. If anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. That new creation has already come. The old is gone, and the new is here. He's given believers a new birth. This is how you're saved. He says, come to me. Come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Come to me. The Lord has given believers a new birth. This is how you're saved. Come to him. The Lord has given believers a new life. This is how you're changed. Live for him. Live for the Lord. And three, the Lord has given believers a new name. And this is how you are known. Stand with him. Stand with him. Is it okay to buy a ticket? I don't know. But don't brag about it. You know, is it okay for you to have a cold one on a summer afternoon? But don't brag about it. God wants us to be different. How different? We may disagree on how different we're supposed to be, but there's no question. The Bible says you're a new creation in Christ Jesus, and you should be different. So what's new, really? Well, it ought to be everything about you after you're saved. Amen? Amen. Lord Jesus, thank you for bringing us to you. Thank you for saving us. Thank you, Lord, that you've given us a new place to worship and a new place to work that we'll enjoy when we go to be with you, when we move into that new heavenly Jerusalem. And thank you, God, you've not only given us a new place, but you've made us new people. You've given us a new life. You've given us a new heart. God, you've given us a new name. We're grateful that everything about us should be new. Thank you for working in us. Thank you for working through us. And God, whatever decisions we make, we pray that at each step along the way, we'd reevaluate and we'd really stop and ask, Lord, am I doing okay? Lord, am I doing okay? Lord, is this okay with you? God, is this okay? Jesus, is this making you happy? Jesus, is this okay? Jesus, you want me to do anything different? God, you want me to change anything? Lord, what would you like me to do? Jesus, what would you like me to do? And I pray that we would do a better job of listening to you. And I pray that we do a better job of living for you. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you guys. Thanks for coming. And when you win, be sure to tithe.